please make your way in and have a seat? So a very warm welcome to you all this morning. It's lovely to see you here at St Luke's. My name is Julia, if you don't know me. A special welcome to any visitors we might have today, or maybe just people we haven't seen for a little while. It's really lovely to have you here. Please stay for a coffee after the service. And yes, I can say that again now, because isn't it nice that we can enjoy a cuppa again after the service? So don't just out of habit shoot straight out the door and into the car park. Go a little bit further into the hall and have a hot drink and the opportunity to share some fellowship after the service. Kids' church has not started back. I'm actually not seeing many children here today, but parents, don't worry. If little ones need to move around, that's fine by us. And there is a side room here you can access if you need it. Actually looks a bit more like a furniture storage room than a playroom at the moment, but it could be useful. So it's the last day of January today. Kids are back at school, and I hope that went well. People are going back to work again after mainly working from home last year. We're endeavouring to find the new COVID normal, aren't we? But we look ahead to the year with optimism, I hope, and renewed energy after the summer break. It's wonderful to see some of our church programs are starting up again. More about that to come. Ken will be starting a new sermon series this morning on the life of the eagle. I hope I've got that right, Ken, and I'm looking forward to hearing that message today. A couple of weeks ago, I spotted this little leaflet on the table outside. I'm not sure where it came from. Maybe it came on a Sunday that I wasn't here. And you may have all read it already. However, I was a bit later to read it, and I just wanted to share the second reading for it. And the reading is from Deuteronomy, chapter 11. But the land you are crossing the Jordan to take possession of is a land of mountains and valleys that drinks rain from heaven. It is a land the Lord your God cares for. The eyes of the Lord your God are continually on it from the beginning of the year to its end. This year you will face some mountains and go through some valleys, and you need both. The strength gained from climbing and conquering your last mountain is what will get you through your next valley. It's in the valley that the sweetest fruit grows. That's because it's watered by streams that flow from the mountains. Jesus said, "By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples." That's from John 15. This year, Jesus wants you to be more, I should say us. This year, Jesus wants us to be more fruitful in his service. And he tells us how, also in John. "Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing." What kind of fruit is God looking for in our lives this year? Paul tells us when the Holy Spirit controls our lives, he will produce this kind of fruit in us: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. It's not a matter of working industriously and efficiently to produce a bountiful harvest out of our own efforts. It's a matter of abiding in the vine, God, so the Spirit can work on our behalf. So this year, when we face mountains or go through a valley, remember that God is with us. Let us pray. Lord, you remind us in your word that you will be with us as we move over the hills and through the valleys of life. We pray that because of all that Jesus Christ has done for us, we can have hope in all circumstances if we abide in you. We thank you that we can meet here today in safety and fellowship, and we pray that all we do will bring glory to you. Amen. I'd like to hand over to the music group now for our first song.
That's us. Welcome. Look, I've got Karen here, I've got Esther here, and we like the radio on in the background. Okay, so you know when you sing along and you hear the song come on the radio, but you're the one who sings. So stand, and we want to hear you singing like you're singing along with the radio. This song's called And That My Soul Knows Very Well. Wonderful. Please be seated.
As the year gets started in earnest, we get more and more notices each week, and I'm really happy about that. A very basic one to start with. We had the hall carpet cleaned during the week, so it's all fresh and clean and lovely. And this area is going to be cleaned in the next couple of days, Tuesday, I think. Could we please have a few volunteers to move all the furniture out of this room after the service, unless you don't need it tonight?
We need 20 chairs left for night church.
Is night church tonight?
Yep.
Oh, I thought you shook your head. Yeah. Okay, so we need 20 chairs left for night church, but hope we can, well, you might need to tell us what we need to move. Thank you for that. Community Bible study starts up again on Wednesday the 10th of February. That's Wednesday week. And we will be studying the book of Ephesians. I say we because I plan to be part of it. It will still be done via Zoom. I'm not sure why, but it is. Sarah would love to hear from you if you would like to know more. Is Sarah in or still out? She's still outside. Oh, she's waving out in the foyer. If you would like to know more about this course, or if you'd like to enrol for it, there's a form on the table outside, but have a chat with Sarah about that. I can tell you it's very rewarding. The morning tea roster, as I said, it's great to be able to share morning tea again after our Sunday services. Thank you to those who have volunteered to go back on the roster, and that roster is sitting out on the table in the foyer. If you can put your name down when you're available for the next few weeks, just until the next main roster goes out, and then it will be part of that, of course. And ideally, we do need two people each Sunday to serve, so you could, you know, link up with someone who's already put their name down. Our prayer meeting this coming Saturday, our monthly prayer meeting, is on Saturday morning, and I believe Paul would like to say a couple of words about it.
Thanks. When I asked Julia about saying something about the prayer meeting, I wasn't exactly sure what I was going to say, but In this place, we need to be serving the Lord and hearing from him. The Bible says that the house of God shall be a house of prayer. And we need to be praying. We need to be listening to God. We need to be praying with each other. We don't get that much of an opportunity in a church service. And we really need to meet together in order to move forward, in order to hear what God wants us to do as we move forward. And some of you might not get an opportunity, if you're sick or if you want to pray for someone who's sick, to come and have people join with you, to hear the heart of other people when they're praying, to be able to feel the sense of God's move as we pray together. I want to encourage you this year, at least come once or twice through the year, so that you get the sense of what God is doing in this place through the prayer. You know, from the very beginning, when we had no minister here and we were down to 12, we instituted a four-hour prayer meeting every first Saturday of the month, and that's continued, but it's gone down to an hour. So I hope that's not too inconvenient, but I'd really like to see you there. But more to the point, I think God would like to see you there. Thanks.
Thanks, Paul. So that's 8 o'clock next Saturday, 8 till 9, or part thereof. If you can't come for the full hour, at least drop by for 10, 15 minutes. That'd be great. Jitterbug's Playgroup is starting up again. Yes! Tuesday and Wednesday this week, which is really exciting. Thanks, Naomi, for getting that started up again. And I know that there are a lot of young families who are going to be very pleased that it's starting because they've really missed it. And we've had some feedback at the food store about that. When's starting up again? And Luke's Place Sunday night service starts up again tonight. How great is that? At this point, I'd like to invite Steve and Brody and Michael as well to come up here. He's just sat down, I know. These terrific people are taking on running the youth groups and night church as volunteers while the positions are being advertised. We just wanted to ask you now whether you might share with us your plans, what's happening, and how we can all support you.
Cool. Well, thanks for having us today, guys. It's great to be back and up and running again. We had a meeting on Thursday, us three, Naomi and Emily and Jasmine. And yeah, we just thought that we should meet together just to get this term planned and up and running. So yeah, obviously Friday nights are a massive ministry, outreach ministry here, where we actually, you know, evangelise to the community, and we thought this was super, super important to get up and running. So we discussed what that would look like for term one. So we've set a date, March the 5th, and we're hoping to run some sort of event. We're not sure what it looks like. We need to meet with our youth team and we need to sort of flesh it out, but we're hoping to be sort of what we've done in the past with our big launch nights, where we run heaps of cool stuff out in the car park, like jumping castles and what else do we have? Fairy floss, bands, that sort of thing, just to sort of get the momentum going for the year. So, yeah. And then obviously Sunday nights are starting up again tonight. So, yeah, we want to sort of get the ball rolling with our church kids and our Christian youth, I should say, not kids. But yeah, so that's really exciting as well. So yeah, we're just going to be running in here and yeah, hopefully we can see many of our kids there. So we thought we should just list a few things that we are going to need in the future. So obviously we're going to be doing this voluntary and then our team's going to be doing this voluntary and that's amazing, but we're going to need a lot of support. So yeah, throughout March, we're starting March the 5th and we're going to run all of March every Friday night. And we might have some off-site events. And so that means we might need some drivers for those events. So yeah, I know it's sort of a while off now, but that'd be great if you know, we could call on a few of you at the time if we need some drivers. We don't know what our numbers are going to be like, so you know, we if we get heaps and heaps of kids, we're going to be sort of over, I guess, I don't know,
40, 50.
Yeah, exactly. So if we get lots of kids, we're going to need a few drivers. That's bottom line. The other thing that we brought up in our meeting is security for Friday night. So this location can get a bit funky at times. So being next to the walking track and all, and in Cockatoo. No, I'm just joking. Look at me. Move to Pakenham. I think I'm so much better than everyone.
Don't you call yourself Cockatoo Burger?
Yeah. So anyway, that's not the point. Obviously, we want this site to be secure on a Friday night, and we've had a few people do this in the past. Pretty much you just hear, you don't have to like stand on the door like a bouncer or anything, but you can come in, and it's also a really good opportunity to see how the programs run and see what we do, and also meet some of the kids because they're fantastic as well. So that's going to be a thing that we need. And, you know, this is preferably, yeah, obviously not us because we'll be doing stuff, just some older people just to be here. Men or women, like this is not a gender-specific thing, but, yeah, just whatever you're comfortable with as well, because if there is an issue that arises, we've obviously got our protocols, but, yeah, it'll be a bit of quick acting. Look, I'm not sure what would happen, but you know, you just got to be on the ball. And then finally, prayer support. Just sort of in the lead up to our Friday night ministries and Sunday nights starting up tonight, yeah, just a lot of prayer support would be awesome. So however that looks like the Saturday morning prayer which Paul was discussing, or just in your own prayer life, that would be fantastic. So have I missed anything? Awesome. All right,
that I can think of.
Okay.
That's really exciting, isn't it? Isn't it great to hear? We're going to pray for them. I know we've got the 1.5 metre rule, but if a couple of people would like, or a few people would like to come and stand behind us and in active support, that would be good, but keep 1.5 metres. And those that don't come, if you could just put your hand out in front like that towards them, because I'm going to pray for them. So let's do that. If you'd like to come forward, you can come forward too. It's like a Billy Graham crusade.
Yeah.
Lord, we want to thank you for the youth ministry that's been a part of St. Luke's for many years. We thank you for what's happened here in this place. We thank you particularly for the ministry of Caleb, who's just left us. We thank you for the number of young people who have been encouraged in their walk with you, for those who have come to know you personally through this group as well. We thank you for the seeds that have been sown in so many people's lives. And we thank you for the outreach to the community that's taken place in the past. And now, Lord, we're on the edge of something excitingly new. And we want to thank you for these three guys for that standing here, for Stephen and Brody and Michael. We thank you for their willingness to commit their time voluntarily to this task. We pray that you bless them, that you give them vision about how you would have them go about the youth ministry and the night church. Lord, open up avenues that they never thought about before. Help them to be passionate, as they we know they are. Help them just increase that passion for the youth and for the ministry that they're going to be a part of. We pray that you would give them all the grace and strength that they need to minister week in and week out. And we thank you that you promise that your grace is sufficient to meet whatever we come up against. So we pray that you'd pour your Holy Spirit out upon them. and help them to move in your spirit and to hear his voice and follow his promptings and see great things happen through this ministry. And we pray that this might be even more effective than it's ever been before. We pray that the Night Church would just really rock with many young people here and you receiving the praise and glory that you deserve. We pray that we'd see many young people come into your kingdom, but we pray that there'd be, as they move out from here too, that there would be a ripple effect on the communities that they come from as well. So we commission these three leaders to you. We commission the group to you and look forward with great excitement, Lord, to what you're going to do here. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
I think that's the end of notices, unless somebody's got something that I've forgotten about. No hands waving. I'll invite Bruce up now. Thank you.
Okay, this morning's prayer is slightly different, I suspect. When I was preparing for this, the reality was that I was struggling, really struggling, to come to grips with some of the things that were going on. It's been one of those two-week periods where it's hatch, match and dispatch, and almost on the same day, what's more. But there's been a lot going on. And as we start into February, there's a lot going on. And when we come to prayer, there's a lot going on. So what do you pray? How do you pray? And I was immediately brought by the Lord back to Paul's letter to the Romans. And in verse 26 and 7, it says, "In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God." The human problem is that in our weakness, we cannot pray as God intends. The divine provision is that the Spirit intercedes with inexpressible groaning, with the ultimate purpose that God searches our hearts. That's the prayer center. Searches our hearts to discern the intention of the Spirit's intercession. The Spirit acts on our behalf. So even this morning, with the failing words that we're going to speak, it's the Spirit that looks in our hearts and says, "Do you actually believe what you're talking about? Are you actually expecting answers?" And there, that's the struggle that we're going through from time to time. So let's just come before the Lord and pray and let the Spirit listen to our hearts, look at our attitude and discern the intention. Let's pray. Like sparrows, we feel like small, little insignificant things in a large and threatening world. We feel helpless before the strong winds of life. We seem so ordinary. Yet, God, you have made us with incomparable worth. Father, we are crowded out by circumstances of our own choosing, seeking fellowship with each other rather than with you. Forgive our unwillingness to follow in the footsteps of your saints, to meet with you in the solitude of your creation. Forgive us our unwillingness to get our feet wet. As school begins back and as the programs begin this particular month of February, We are being set up, and it's a time of need, a time to listen to God even more so than normal. And we ask for your touch on your family, your fellowship here at Cockatoo and Jembrook and online. We also need to think of all who are in our fellowship, in our community, who are suffering or have had loss or who have had joy or who just don't know. Lord, come near and provide your help, your peace, your grace, your mercy. Give to us your gift of compassion and service, so that in service we may not grumble, but we may listen to your Spirit, that we may be your helps and your servants in this community and to each other. We seek your intervention in the world of pandemic. Again, we plead for your hand of mercy and a safety for our community. Guide your church here at Cockatoo and Jembrook, and as we live stream to the communities, make known to us, your servants, what is necessary to lead your community, what is necessary to be done, how we can help each other, that we may continue to serve and worship you in your name in this place. Grant our Father that in our worship today, those who've grown weary of life will find hope. Those confused will find clarity. Those bitter will discover happiness. Those who live in peril will find safety. And the lonely find friendship. And those who have lost life and lost life's meaning will find holiness again. And all this we ask in the Lord's name, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Thank you, Bruce. Please stand with me. Just stay in that attitude of prayer, with that connection with God. Stand with me. We're going to sing a song called Great is the Lord.
Great is the Lord and most worthy. want to thank you for the work you've done in our lives. Lord, we trust in your unfailing love. For you alone are God eternal throughout earth and heaven above.
That was the offering song. Okay, we're not going to sing it again, but the ladies are handing around the offering bowl. Again, don't touch it, but you may put things in there. If you came prepared to do that this morning, you might want to say hello to someone around you while you're doing that. Have a seat, and Tim will be up here.
Guys, I'll get you to grab a seat again. Thank you. Well done. It's those moments in church where you just want to catch up with everyone. It's good. It's great. Let me pray for the offertory and then we'll have our Bible reading. Lord God, we want to just thank you for this, all that you give us, the amazing gifts that you give us. And we just want to pray that you bless this offering and that it goes to the great work. It goes to people becoming followers of you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to be reading from Isaiah 40, verse 25 to 31, if you'd like to break that out either on your phones or in your Bibles. Mine's on my phone. It starts like this. To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry hosts one by one and calls forth each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. This is the word of the Lord.
We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait.
My bottle's 1.5 metres away from the offering basket. Let's pray and begin. Lord God, we worship you. We just want to say we adore you. We stand amazed that you are the everlasting God. You are our strength. You are our deliverer. And you raise us up on wings like eagles. We count it such an honour, such a blessing to know you and to have you in our life. And as we come to hear you speak to us this morning from your word, we pray that your Holy Spirit would just come and bring your word alive to us. Give us a hunger to hear from you. And Lord God, use this word this morning to bring transformation to our lives and how we do life. And may it all bring glory back to you, Lord Jesus. For we ask it in your name. Amen.
Amen.
With the overseas travel restrictions likely to be around for some time, as many of you know, most Aussies are planning holidays in Australia, within Australia. And as I thought of this, my mind back to when we and our children spent most of our holidays. And because we were in the northwest of New South Wales in ministry up there in Tamworth and Narrabri and a town called Warriolda, we used to often go up to the Gold Coast or just above the Gold Coast to a place called Mount Tambourine, which is in the hinterland of the Gold Coast. Anybody ever been up there? Yeah, you know what it's like. Okay. It's a beautiful place, beautiful scenery, aside from the cake shop in the main street, which has a lovely display there. there's scenic rainforests, there's waterfalls, glowworms, and did I say cake shop? Yep, yeah, cake shop I did. There's bushwalks, there's views down the coast to the Gold Coast and the ocean, and there's views out west into the valleys and an incredible mountain range in the distance. But unfortunately, no cake shops. One of the most amazing sights that I still think about in Mount Tambourine was seeing the hang gliders jumping off the side of the mountain and just circling above you. They'd sit there sometimes for hours, and you just want, in the end, you wanted to go and push them, say, for heaven's sake, will you jump? But they waited, and they caught the thermals, and off they would take up into the air. And that was amazing. I used to love watching that. But even more amazing was what was above them. Soaring above them were these awesome, majestic eagles, soaring effortlessly and gliding on the wind thermals and currents up high. And they were reigning like kings of the skies. It's interesting. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 18 says, "There are three things in life too amazing for me, one of which is the way of an eagle in the sky." Now, I know that if you live around here, you know a lot about eagles too, and Joe just told me about in Abbotsley, there are huge eagles up there as well. There's something special about eagles, and they've been recognised by people throughout cultures and across time. The eagle's image has appeared on coins, on money notes, on stamps, on emblems, on flags, on medals, on church lecterns. On the US presidential plane is known as, do you know what it is? Eagle One, that's right. And Buzz Aldrin's spacecraft that first landed on the moon was named Eagle. And when it landed, do you remember that what the control center announced? The eagle has landed, the eagle has landed. Eagles appear in poetry, they appear in songs, they appear on golf. You can get an eagle in golf. They appear in names of places like Eagle's Way on the Austrian Mountains Walk. And I have actually seen eagles land on stage and begin to sing. Yes, I've seen them land on stage and begin to perform. They sing songs like Hotel California, one of these nights, and Heartache Tonight. Carlos Stringer, who's written a book called, what's it called? Yeah, On Eagle's Wings, said, "Few creatures inspire humans to the extent of an eagle. And it's interesting that in the Bible, eagles are mentioned at least 32 times. Proverbs 23, Ezekiel 1 and 10, Revelation 4. But the best-known passages about eagles are Psalm 103, verse 5. The Lord satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth, your vigor, your strength is renewed like the eagles. And then Isaiah 40 that we just heard. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. And they will rise up like eagles. And do you know that in actual fact that God actually compares himself to an eagle and to a mother eagle's care for her young? And in Exodus 19, he says, "You yourselves have seen what I did in Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." What a beautiful, loving and caring picture that is of Father God and his care for the people of Israel, but also for us. You know, there are so many things we can learn from eagles that relate to how we follow Jesus in our lives. And I'd like to share with you just 55 of them today. Hopefully over the next few months I get a chance to share some other ones. But there are many qualities, for example, of eagles that God would have us have in our own life. For example, physical strength and power and character of the eagle that other birds do not have. Eagles have a fierce level of commitment to whatever tasks they take on, to parenting their children, but also to their partner. They will not leave their partner until that partner passes away. They're committed for a lifetime. Eagles have exceptional vision. They often see what other birds can't see. They can see through what's immediately in front of them to opportunities kilometres away in the distance, and nothing gets past them. They are confident to stand alone. They are bold, fearless, and courageous. They're not intimidated by others or enemies or circumstances. So much so that they've actually been known to take on hang gliders in the sky. And even some nutty eagles actually take on planes. You know, when they're flying in a certain direction or gliding in a certain direction, a plane's coming, it virtually says to the plane, "Get out of my way." And they take them on. They don't always come off really well after it, but they're not fearful of them. There are two particular features about eagles that I want to share with you today, and they relate particularly to our journey of following Jesus. First of all, nesting. Eagles make huge nests, weighing as much as 2 tons and 3 meters wide, lined with leaves, grass, animal fur, and often their mother eagle's feathers. And they're made, with such great skill and strength that the nest can fall thousands of metres without coming apart. Eagles make their nests occasionally high in trees, but most times they make it on a rock face of a cliff where there's the strength of the rock behind them and underneath them, and the nest is safe from people and animals. So Job says in chapter 36, "Does the eagle soar at your command and build its nest on high? He dwells on a cliff and stays there at night. A rocky crag is his stronghold." Now I want to say to you that the key to life, the key to experiencing life in all its fullness and being a follower of Jesus, is building our life on the rock of Jesus Christ, building our lives personally on him, but also building our lives on his teaching. In Psalm 18, it says, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress." In other words, we're to build our life on Jesus and make him our rock, the fortress, the one that we stand strong on, the one we run to and hide in when times are difficult. Luke chapter 6, remember Jesus said, "I will show you what it's like when someone comes to me, listens to my teaching and follows it. They are like a person building a house who digs deep and lays the foundation on solid rock." I want to encourage you, build your life on Jesus, the rock. He will not move. When your life is on him, you will not be shaken. And he's your refuge. He's the key to experiencing life in all its fullness and life forevermore in heaven. Build your life on the rock. Hey, it's an interesting question I come across. How do you identify a bald eagle? Well, I looked up the answers, and the most logical one was all his feathers are combed to one side. Well, for the first 3 months of a baby, you just got it, did you? For the first 3 months of a baby eaglet's life, they are nurtured, well-fed, and kept comfortable in the safety and security of the nest. And nothing is spared by the mother in raising her family. Then one day, a big change comes. The mother eagle is aware that the time has come for her young to start flying lessons and get ready to leave the nest. But she's also aware that the eaglets need encouragement to do so. They're having it pretty good inside the nest there. And so one morning she spreads her wings and takes off, borne aloft by a gentle breeze. And she simply, I hope you appreciate this, she actually hovers just above the nest in front of the eaglet's eyes, slowly beating her giant wings just enough to maintain control. And the idea is to direct the little eaglet's eyes to the function of those things on their mother's back called wings. And she repeats this day after day after day. Eventually, the young begin to understand, and they too spread their wings, a bit reluctantly, and flutter around the huge nest. Sometimes a breeze catching their wings and lifting them up, but they are clumsy, and usually they tumble back to the safety of the nest. And days pass as the young eaglets rev up their engines, trying to soar aloft. And often the mother decides it's time to start the actual flight training. But because there is some reluctance for their eaglets to leave the nest, the food supply is cut back. For the first 3 months, the mother or father would bring back the food, drop it in their beaks, and it was easy going, just a Big Mac or something like that. But as the time goes on, and as she wants them to encourage them to leave, the food supply is reduced. And at times, it's held out at a distance. So rather than drop it in their beak, it's held back towards the edge of the nest. So the actual eaglets have to flap their wings and strengthen their wings and move towards... This must look terrible if you're watching this. They must have to flap their wings and move out towards the food in order to eat it. And often the parents then do another thing to encourage their young to leave. They begin to shake and dismantle the comfort and security of the nest, begin to tear it apart. And you can imagine what's going through the minds of the eaglets, also gazing with fear over the side and the sheer precipice and rocks that weigh down. You can imagine them inside saying, "Mum and Dad, I'm not real keen on this idea. Can we play Monopoly instead? What are you doing? Don't you love me? Don't you care for me anymore?" Deuteronomy 32 says, "As the eagle stirs up her nest, flutters over her young, and spreads abroad her wings, she takes them and bears them on her wings." Well, with all those things happening in front of their eyes, the baby eaglets practice flapping about the nest and adjacent branches until they gain confidence and the necessary flight skills. And Mother Eagle has been actually known to encourage her young to deal with fear by actually nudging them and shepherding them towards the edge of the nest. I would have hated to have a mother like that. I have a great fear of heights. But that's what a mother eagle often does. And when the time comes and the eaglet falls or voluntarily leaves the nest, great option, often it will plunge. It'll spiral out of control, struggling desperately to stay aloft as it speeds towards the rocks below. What does a mother eagle do? Well, the parent eagle actually flies alongside the tumbling eaglet and uses its massive beating wings to form air pockets, whirlpools of air, an updraft that actually provides the baby eagle with the necessary lift to keep it alive. And wonder of wonders, as it's lifted up, the eagle begins to flap and to fly. He or she is a little rough at first, and I'm told that many, many eaglets often in their first attempt to fly often fly into a tree or two. Oh, well, what's that? Or they may bounce off a rock. But they're flying. That's good. Rather injured, but they're flying. And the process is repeated over and over again. The birds go back to the nest, the mother flaps, watch shows them, and then they are moved out again and they drop, and the updraft carries them back up again and again. Now, I just thought, you know, this goes on and on until the eaglets finally get the picture of how much the mother eagle cares for them, but how they're also intended to fly. And isn't that a picture of what the Lord does with us, is ready to do with us again and again? I don't know about you, but don't our lives plunge out of control at times? Don't you find that your life is spiraling and you're heading rather quickly towards the rocks? And if you have the Lord in your life, he is willing to spread his wings of grace, and to create an updraft and to lift you back up again as you feel like I'm surely going to destruction. Isn't that good? Yeah, it's good. The two of us agree with that. Exodus 19 says again, "You yourself have seen what I did in Egypt, how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." And when your life is spiraling out of control, that's what the Lord is prepared to do for you. I got to thinking too, there are times when our nests, the very things that we place our trust and our security and our comfort and our hope in, get stirred up. Bruce talked about that this morning, dismantled and torn apart. As a church, we've been experiencing our nest being dismantled, haven't we? We've lost the Prout family as leaders of our church. We hadn't lost Caleb as a youth pastor, and the list goes on. Our nest is being stirred up here. It's being shaken. And personally, many of us have had our nests shaken as well, in particularly in the last 12 months with the coronavirus and all the implications of that. And I began to think a little bit further, because this was my thinking day. This was Thursday. The other five days, I don't worry about it. Why would the Lord allow or sometimes cause our nest to be shaken? Why would he allow our nests to be dismantled? And why would he even edge us out of the nest? Well, I want to introduce just a couple of things that I think are possibilities. But I want to say, first of all, like everything else that happens in our life, when the Lord allows our lives and our nests to be shaken, it's always with good intentions. It's always because he loves us, and always because he has something better in store for us. It's never to punish us or to cause us to be destroyed or whatever it may be. You remember what he said in Jeremiah 29 to the exiles coming back? "I know the plans I have for you, not to destroy you, but to give you a future and a hope." So keep that in mind. So why do our nests need to be shaken and dismantled at times? Well, I don't know about you, sometimes I need my nest shaken so that my life gets realigned, so I get back on track, so I get things back in perspective. Sometimes I need my nest to be shaken to remind me what really matters in life, who and what should be at the centre of my life, and where my trust and security and hope should be. So sometimes my nest needs to be shaken so that my life gets realigned and back in the right perspective. Sometimes our nests need to be shaken to remind us that we are designed not to be nest dwellers. You and I are not to be nest dwellers. We were made in Jesus to be different to all the other birds around us. We were not meant to stay in the safety and security of the church, in our little ghettos or whatever it may be, or in the comfort and security of having people around you. We are called to be a bird that launches out of the nest. We are called to go out and not stay stuck behind four walls. We are called to go out and continue the presence and ministry of Jesus, preaching the good news, healing the sick, releasing those in prison, bringing discovery of sight to the blind that Jesus talked about in Luke 4. Our nests sometimes get shaken because sometimes we become so secure together that we forget that our purpose is to come together to go out. And so our nests need to be shaken for that reason. Sometimes our nests need to be dismantled because the Lord wants to launch us to greater heights and to higher places, greater and greater altitudes spiritually and in our relationship with him. He wants to take us higher with him than we've ever experienced before. I find that exciting, don't you? Good, thank you. Sometimes he dismantles our nests because he wants to launch us into something new. Sometimes we get so stuck in a rut or in a comfort place of comfort, but God wants to launch us into a new ministry, a new direction, a new project. And the only way he can do that is to shake up our lives. So we begin to look at what I'm doing. Should I be doing this? Should I be doing something new? Joyce Meyer said, "When our nests are shaken, don't panic or be overwhelmed with fear. God hasn't stopped loving you. Hold tightly to him, wait in his presence, and listen closely to what he's trying to teach you so that you can rise to new heights with him." All good reasons for God wanting to shake our nets, but there's one final reason that God wants to shake our nests up, and it's like the eagle. He shakes our nests and dismantles our comfort zones at times because he wants to launch us into a life of flying. A life of flying? Did I say flying? Actually, eagles don't technically fly. They soar. They wait and wait, much like that hang glider, and to the right time, and they catch the thermals or the wind currents and launch out into the wind current and allow the current to take them higher and higher and to different places effortlessly. And the wind current empowers them to go wherever they want to go. In actual fact, research has been done that an eagle can stay up all day without being exhausted, just catching one current after one current after another current together. Well, this is encouraging stuff because, like the eagle, the Lord made us individually and collectively, and sometimes edges us out, for a life of rising up and soaring. He wants us to soar in the thermals of the Holy Spirit, an exciting day-by-day, moment-by-moment experience, a life of learning to let the Holy Spirit fill and direct our lives, allowing the Spirit to support us, to guide us, and empower us to follow Jesus. The Christian life, the life of following Jesus, is not to be a life that's frantic and exhaustive effort, where we wear as a badge of pride that we got burnt out serving Jesus. It's not meant to be that at all. It's not meant to be a life that we try to follow Jesus in our own strength and our own resources, and it's hard work all the time. The life of following Jesus is meant to be a life of waiting on the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, of learning to be sensitive to his flow, to his movement, to what he's doing, to what he wants of us, of being sensitive to his promptings and leadings in our life, and then being willing to let go and launch out with our wings of faith, faith in the Word of God and faith in the promises, and moving out and soaring with him throughout the day, letting him lead us, letting him carry us, letting him empower us, and especially when we're tired and feeling weary. It's moving and partnering with him where he's ministry and working. I find that really exciting and transformational because we're not often taught that in the church. It's all about trying harder, putting the effort in, hard slog and so on, but it's not meant to be that way. It's meant to be a life of relying on the Spirit of God. And who better was that a picture of than Jesus? Remember in Luke chapter 4, he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, set the captives free, bring recovery of sight to the blind. It was all, he was saying, everything I do is in reliance upon the Holy Spirit. And Jesus lived a Spirit-filled life in his ministry. As we wait on the Lord and as we rely upon the Spirit of God, we will be refreshed, we will be renewed, we will be transformed. We will be far more fruitful than we've ever been in ministry. We will be strengthened. We will be filled with joy, and we will rise up. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, and they're going to rise up on wings like eagles. Ephesians 5:18 says, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Galatians 5 says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. That's the life that you've been called to live. A life of soaring, the thermals of the Holy Spirit. I want to close and tell you a story. A farmer once took an egg from an eagle's nest, and he took it home and placed it under one of his hens, and it hatched with a little brood of chickens. The farmer raised the bird with great patience and attempted to tame him. And the eagle never really seemed to fit in with the chickens. It always walked alone. It couldn't seem to relate or interact with the other chickens around him. As the eagle grew, he realized something seemed to be deeply wrong inside of him. And even though he'd not ever known any other existence but life in the chicken yard, it just didn't feel like home to him. He wanted to leave the chicken yard and take to the skies. He even tried to do so. And the farmer finally had to clip the eagle's wings to keep him from flying away. So since the eagle could not fly, he just sat in the chicken yard, looking up at the sky. One day a storm began to brew, and the sky grew dark, and all the barnyard animals scurried around for cover. And the chickens were terribly frightened, as chickens are prone to be. And the eagle sat watching the scene in front of him, realising that the storm didn't frighten him in the least. And at that moment, he couldn't help but stretch out his wings. And as he did, he noticed that the farmer had failed to keep them clipped. And suddenly his eye caught sight of a great eagle riding the wind above him, his wings outstretched in majestic form. And the eagle that was raised as a chicken looked again at the chickens, scurrying around frantically, then returned his gaze to the eagle soaring peacefully above him, then looked back at the chickens and then up at the eagle again. And he heard the eagle in the sky let out an awesome, piercing cry. And in that instant, he knew he had to get out of the chicken yard. And a mighty gust of wind swept beneath his outstretched wings and lifted him into the air. And with a shrill of victory and freedom, he took off from the barnyard forever. He found a thermal and rose right out of sight. And with grace, he glided to and fro, majestic in the air. With wingtips stretched, he soared and soared high in the sky. He sure belongs up there. You are not chickens. You are eagles. You weren't meant to scurry around in the chicken yard. You were meant to soar in the skies, to rise above whatever's happening about you, and to be conquerors over every storm. And you were meant to soar the thermals of the Holy Spirit. And I want to encourage you this morning, while Australian planes may be presently grounded, we don't need to be. Don't flutter around in the nest and barnyard anymore. Learn to spread your wings of faith. Learn to launch out on the thermals of the Holy Spirit and soar. For you were created for the high places.
Thanks, Ken. It's an instruction, challenge, and promise. All of those things. And I love that song. Strength will rise as we are really busy. Strength will rise as we're running around doing heaps of things. Strength will rise as we're planning for what's coming up next. No, that wasn't it, was it? The strength will... I heard you singing. I was singing. Strength will rise as we what? Wait. Oh. As we wait, don't we hate waiting? Waiting for the bus, waiting for that parcel to arrive, waiting for restrictions to change, waiting on our surfboards for that wave to come. We don't like it. We always want to get our minds busy. But the key to what we're talking about this morning is being able to wait on the Lord to, through the challenges, through the boredom, through the anxiety, through whatever's going on, to get to that place, which is, it sounds absolutely amazing. Stand with me. We're going to sing a song, and it's called Eagle's Wings. It's about waiting and abiding and just spending some time with God so that we can rise and get to that place that we've heard about this morning. I've forgotten how the intro is going to go, Esther, so just bear with me.
Abiding me, I
your love.
Hide me in your love. Bring me to my knees. May I know Jesus more and more. Come live.
There's another song, but I'm going to leave it there. I think that was just a fantastic way to finish our worship this morning. I'm going to invite Julie back up.
Thanks. Thanks, Jeff and the music team for that. Just have a seat for another minute. It's a bit more comfortable to sit down. So that just about winds up our service for today. Thanks, Ken, for your message. I've certainly learned a lot about eagles this morning, but what a great illustration of God's provision and care for us. Please stay and enjoy some morning tea together in the hall, and please remember, if you can possibly help us move some furniture, that would be great. If you would like to talk more about the sermon with Ken, I'm sure he'd be very willing to have a chat with you if some of the things he talked about stirred up something in you and you'd like to find out more. And if you have prayer needs this morning, I might ask Paul to stay with me down the front for a little while after the service. And if anyone needs prayer, please come down and have a chat with us. It's been great having you spending the morning with us here at St Luke's. And we all look forward, don't we, to see what the new year is going to bring to us here. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and strength to our lives. Take and use us to love and serve all people in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.